Good morning and welcome to the Erwin Rommel Mobile Law School live seminar at Dallas, Texas. I'm Peter John Simpson, and we always start our seminars off the same way. We do that because we may be crazy, but we're not stupid. This is the 91st Psalm from the Jerusalem Bible. If you live in the shelter of Elyon and make your home in the shadow of Shaddai, you can say to Yahweh, my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. He rescues you from the snares of fowlers hoping to destroy you. He covers you with his feathers, and you find shelter underneath his wings. You need not fear the terrors of night, the arrow that flies through the daytime, the plague that stalks in the dark, the scourge that wreaks havoc in broad daylight. Though 1,000 fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, you yourself will remain unscathed with his faithfulness for shield and buckler. You have only to look around you to see how the wicked are repaid. You who can say, Yahweh, my refuge, and make Elyon your fortress. No disaster can overtake you, no plague come near your tent. He will put you in his angels' charge to guard you wherever you go. They will support you on their hands in case you hurt your foot against a stone. You'll tread on lion and adder, trample on savage lions and dragons. I rescue all who cling to me. I protect whoever knows my name. I answer everyone who invokes me. I am with them when they are in trouble. I bring them safety and honor. I give them life long and full, and show them how I can save. Our legal system comes direct from the Bible. For those of you confused by the Old Testament, this is the Jerusalem Bible. This is a Catholic Bible published, translated from the French into the English in 1966 with the Catholic Church's Neil Obstadt and imprimatur. And what it does is it makes the convoluted language of the King James Old Testament very, very accessible to you and a lot of newcomers to the Bible as law, as opposed to religious hooliganism, use this Bible to make clear their King James, and then they code plead the King James in Strong's and do their research from there. Our featured presenter is Michael H. Brown. Michael H. Brown in talk radio in America is known as America's foremost jailhouse lawyer. While you and I mostly were sitting around in our dorm rooms listening to Beatle albums, Michael Brown was the first American sent to federal prison over the abortion issue. He was given 25 years, and he was first taught legal research and pleading in federal prison by an old librarian at Terre Haute, Indiana. And he got himself out in 4.5 years. The Erwin Rommel School of Law is not a monolith. You will hear different opinions between Dwayne and myself and Michael on various topics, particularly citizenship arguments, status arguments, and jurisdictional discussions. Quite plainly, Dwayne will readily admit to you, as will I, when it comes to civil litigation, and particularly when it comes to criminal defense litigation, both Dwayne and I readily defer to Mr. Brown. Michael Brown got his first guy out of federal prison in 1974, and he has been attacking legal problems with what can only be charitably described as a methodical violence ever since. And so, Dallas, bolt your socks to your shoes. Here's the field marshal himself, Michael H. Brown.
Thank you. And Peter, it was 3.5 years, not 4.5. Okay, now, I know this may sound a little strange to some of you, that why we call this the Erwin Rommel School of Law. There are several reasons for this. The first is that when you go into an American courtroom, and this has been true since before our Revolutionary War, what you're doing is you're actually using words on paper instead of bullets. What you're going to find is our court system has almost reached the point of terminal uselessness. However, if you just pay a little attention here with what I'm about to teach you, and I'm not going to get up here and say I've won every case I've ever fought, because anybody who does that, he's basically somebody who won his first case and then quit. That doesn't happen. A lot of times you'll lose a case simply because the judges just do what they want to do because they're undisciplined. Now, what I'm going to teach you here today and tomorrow is not only, I'm not only going to teach you military strategy and tactics in a courtroom, but when you leave here tomorrow, if you even pay half the amount of attention you're supposed to, you will qualify as a suer. In other words, you'll be able to sue people. You'll know how to fill out the forms. You'll know how to go to court. You'll know how to pay the docketing fees, service of process. It's not that simple. Lawyers can do it. Anybody can do it. Now, first thing you have to understand, everybody here got their weapon with them? There you go. That's it. That's your weapon. Pad of paper, that's your ammunition. You'd be amazed at how much damage you can do with this stuff. Now, the first thing I have to do here, and you're going to have to bear with me just a little bit as I go through these index cards, because it's far more important that you get all the information than I get up here and give a really professional, polished speech. First thing I want you to write down is you'll hear a lot of rumors, and people are putting out literature and all that, and they'll tell you this and they'll tell you that. Well, most of these rumors and what we call patriot mythology, like you can use the Uniform Commercial Code in a criminal case. Well, that's only if you're accused of stealing something or you wrote a check or something like that. There's a real easy way to check this. It's called Black's Law Dictionary. And I would suggest that's the one book that you should get before you even start, because anybody starts talking to you about UCC or citizenship or anything like that, it's real simple. You go to Black's Law Dictionary and look it up. Something else I want to caution you on, and this is an absolute must. The law is not what I tell you it is. It is not what someone else tells you it is. It isn't what the judge tells you it is. The law is what's in the books. You have to learn how to read those books. Now, another thing I would suggest, and this is something that you're also going to have to become very familiar with, is there's a four-letter word that attorneys shy away from. Can anyone tell me what it is? What? Yes. No? Now, let's keep it simple, stupid. They hate it even worse than that. Can anyone else want to guess? The word, ladies and gentlemen, is read. In other words, most attorneys are too busy chasing ambulances, lying to clients, figuring out how they can get into their clients' pockets without doing any work. They will not read the law books. And as proof of this, I would suggest you pick up any treatise on legal malpractice. You're going to find 97% of all legal malpractice suits are filed against attorneys who have had more than 4 years' experience. In other words, it takes them about 4 years after they get out of law school to learn how to steal from people. Now, another thing that you've got to caution yourself on here is, you know, I hear a lot of these wonderful fairy tales. I heard them from Peter when I first met him. There's two things that you have to have when somebody tells you something that sounds too wonderful to be believed and you want to try the same thing. It's called the name of the court and the docket number. Because if you have the name of the court and you have a docket number, you can call up the court clerk, you can buy a copy of the whole case. And once you've done that, you can read the case and see if the case says what these people say that it says. I'll give you an example. It's down in Florida with Peter a couple of years ago, and we heard, this thing came over the Patriot Facts Network. It was about how some federal judge had ordered the National Guard to take over the banks. I mean, really sounded wonderful. So the announcer was just about ready to go on the air with this thing. I said, hey, wait a minute, gentlemen. I said, we don't know if this is true or not. Let me call the court clerk there in Denver first. So I called the court clerk, and she says, you know, this is funny. She says, you're the dozens guy that's called today? I said, really? What's this case about? She said, oh, it's some group of farmers in some argument with some bank. I said, oh, it doesn't say this, this, and this. And she said, no, okay? Now, the first thing I want to give you to live by here, because remember, this is a how-to seminar. In other words, I may not be the greatest speaker you ever heard, but if you pay even half the attention you're supposed to, like I said earlier, what you're going to find is when you walk out of here tomorrow, you will know how to sue somebody. You'll know how to take it all the way through. Now, the first thing I want to do is show you this. This is something you have to live by. I don't want you forgetting it. Show me what works. In other words, if it doesn't work, if nobody has ever tried it before, it may work. But if someone has tried and failed with it before, I'll double damn guarantee you it's going to fail for you too, probably in a worse fashion. In fact, there's an attorney, I'm not going to mention his name, but he put a piece of work together a few years back in California, sent it up to Ninth Circuit. They said this is frivolous. They sent it back on him. Second time he went up there, they sanctioned him $2,500. Now, what I'm going to get into now is, first, I've got to get your mindset. I know a lot of you have heard this business about you're a sovereign citizen and you have rights and so forth and so on. Well, you know, I hate to rain on your parade here, but I'm going to introduce you to the real world in the American court system. The first is, and this is from a quote from a guy named Alexis, Comte de Tocqueville, 1835, 1839. It's a book called Democracy in America. And what he said was, the American aristocracy can be found in the lawyer's bar and the judge's bench. In 1955, a woman named Nancy Mitford wrote a book in which she pointed out that an aristocracy in a republic is like a chicken with its head cut off. It may run about in a lively way, but in reality, it's dead. My big thing, and I'll show you why after a while, which you've got to become acquainted with, is the biggest problem we have in the legal system is the federal judiciary. They're all appointed for life. Supposedly, they only get removed from office for misbehavior. And most of these people misbehave on a daily basis, so you can see how well that works. This is a quote from a fella, been dead for a while. And remember, we're talking about the federal judiciary and lifetime appointments. That judges of important causes should hold office for life is not a good thing, for the mind grows old as well as the body. Anybody recognize that quote? Man's been dead for about 2,500 years. His name was Aristotle. Now, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to show you the main tactic that you have to employ in the American court system, along with the reason that it doesn't work. And to do that, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go all the way back to the Battle of Hastings. It took place in 1066. Now, can anybody tell me why the Saxons lost that battle? There's a lot of theories out there. English didn't have certain... Now, any of you who've read my introduction to Erwin Rommel, no fair. Okay, I see man over here has got one, so he already knows. 1066 AD. Now, what had happened was this. First, I'm going to give you the tactics that were used that you also have to employ in the American court system, because if you do not, if you are not cognizant of what you're running into, you're going to be living in a middle Disneyland, and when you come back out the other side through the judicial meat grinder, you're going to say, what happened to me? How did I get hit? Well, by the time you understand what's wrong with this system, and I'm going to teach you how to overcome it with these tactics, then you'll say, okay, I know what I'm in for. When I go into court, I understand that the courtroom is a battlefield, the law is a weapon, the judge is my enemy. Let me go all the way back here to 900. 900 AD, we had the death of Alfred the Great. Now, he was a pretty good guy. I mean, this guy was definitely a king after my own heart. Legend has it that he hanged 44 of his own judges in a single day. Okay? And if he runs for king again, I'm voting for him. Okay.
That's why they call him great.
That's right. Okay. Now, in the 166 years from the time of Alfred the Great up until the Battle of Hastings, the English had a succession of weak kings, one of whom I think was named after a lawyer. He was called Ethelred the Unready. And Ethelred was a complete idiot. I mean, this guy took the wives of some of the Danes who had invaded, and instead of just holding them for ransom, he buried them up to their waist and then turned dogs loose on them. You know, that really causes your opponent to lose a sense of humor. Well, what happened was this. From the death of Alfred all the way up to the Battle of Hastings, the English court system operated very much in the fashion ours does today. What happened was this. The English, when a baron got into a legal urinating contest, if you will, with a peasant who had 40 acres and a mule. Well, I think those of you who have had experience in our court system, you know automatically, no matter what the law was, and I see a man nodding his head over here, yeah, you're right, okay, you know how the judge ruled. He did not rule according to law, he ruled according to political position. And this is one of the first things that you have to understand about our system, and I'm going to show you what their system did to them, along with the tactics you need to employ that the Normans used, is that we have a caste system, legal system. If your name is William Kennedy Smith or Neil Bush, there is one set of rules that apply to you. But if your name is Mike Brown, Peter Simpson, and I don't know most of your names here, I can guarantee you there's a different set of rules apply to you, and I'm sure some of you have experienced it. Okay? Now, what happened was, is by the time William the Conqueror landed, and if you read the accounts from that era, what you find out is that most of the guys with William thought he was on a suicide mission. I mean, you just don't take 10,000 men and invade a country of 2.5 million people. It is just not done. Well, here's what happened. William landed. Now, when they met at Hastings, this particular fight started at 9 o'clock in the morning, all right? He had 10,000 men. Harold the Saxon had about the same. Now, a lot of military historians will tell you, well, the English were worn out from Stamford Bridge, that they had fought at like 2 or 3 weeks earlier. That's absolute nonsense, all right? Then they'll tell you that the Normans had invented the stirrup, which the English had never seen before, which meant instead of having to get off your horse to fight, you could now fight from a stirrup, and the Saxon shield wall broke. You'll find all these excuses. The actual fact is, the English were defeated because of their own court system. Here's what happened. 9 o'clock, fight starts. At 5 o'clock in the afternoon, which is like three times your average medieval battle, and I don't know how many of you have seen First Night with Richard Gere. Anybody seen that? Okay, woefully inaccurate. They didn't have plate armor then, they had chain mail. As late as Hastings, hundreds of years later, their shields were mostly made out of wood. The Saxon battle axe was one of the most fearsome weapons ever seen. Guy who knew how to wield it could drop a horse with a single blow. In other words, the Saxons were not outclassed. At 5 o'clock in the afternoon, the Normans had been repulsed in charge after charge. So finally, here's William of Normandy saying, well, got to go for broke. So he took all his infantry, all his cavalry, all his artillery, or archers, and he committed all of them at once on one flank of the English line. And he rolled it up. Now, up until 5 o'clock in the afternoon, it was nip and tuck. Now, I'm going to show you how that works in the court system. I'm going to show you how to bring in artillery. I'm going to show you what infantry is. I'm going to show you what cavalry is with the court analogies. At 5 o'clock, the Saxon line was rolled up, and it was a moonless night, so most of the Saxons got away. All right, now here's William. He's in a strange country. He's got wooden boats that he can get away in. He's got no winter quarters, very little food. Half his army's laying out in the field. A third of them are dead. And another large percentage of them are laying there with arms and legs missing and things like this. It would have been a relatively simple matter for the Saxon forces simply to commit another division the next day and push him back into the English Channel. But it didn't happen. And the reason it didn't happen is this. It was because of their caste system, legal system. Because when William the Conqueror landed, because of the corrupt court system, because of the weak kings that the English had had since the death of Alfred the Great. Anybody recognize what that figure represents? All right, this figure represents the court system in England. And all English history books will tell you this. They don't tell you in this country because they never get into the cause of things. But 80% of the English people had been reduced to serfs and slaves. They did not look upon William the Conqueror as an invader. They looked upon him as a deliverer. And so what they wound up with is what defeated the Saxon kingdom, which means that today we speak English instead of Saxon tongue, which is very close to German. The reason world history was changed was simply because of a corrupt court system that had lasted for a century and a half. Now, can anybody here tell me that they think all the shelter people in this society are people who've been dispossessed of everything they owned, who've had their families brutalized by federal marshals? You know, that's part of that 80% that we're going to come to one of these days if this court system isn't cleaned up. Now, to illustrate this principle goes more than once, let me give you some other dates here. I don't need to go all the way back into the siege of Jerusalem, and I believe it was 587 B.C., but if you read it in the Bible, if you read it carefully, what you find is when Nebuchadnezzar and his troops came in, they only took the middle class, the upper middle class, the royalty, the people who didn't have anything, they just left them there. I mean, they weren't going to do any harm, and they had nothing against the Babylonians to begin with. Let's go up to 1861. Now, my ancestors fought for the Confederacy. And I always thought that, well, there wasn't any reason we should have lost. Well, there was. It's a real simple one. You'll find it in Isaiah 5, verse 8. Woe to those who lay house to house, who join field to field, until there be no place left in the midst of the land. Now, what happened to us was, in the old Confederacy, is that when the war started in 1861, there were 12 million people in the 11 states of the old Confederacy. One-third of them, 4 million, were slaves. Now, the fact is, I don't care who you are or what your racial background is, if you're a slave, who cares who's in charge? You figure one master's just as bad as the next one. I'll give you another example. 1917, the Bolshevik Revolution. Now, I know a lot of the history books over here, they're sympathetic to Tsar Nicholas and all that. The fact is, Tsar Nicholas was an idiot. When an innocent family was killed by one of his officers, instead of Nicholas doing what he was supposed to and saying, hey, wait a minute, we can't have any of this Randy Weaver business here in Russia, he wrote on the notation, good fellow. And you understand why nobody showed him a lot of sympathy. When the Bolsheviks started the revolution in 1917, they had the same percentage. 80% of the people in what is now the Soviet Union were serfs and slaves. It was the same thing, exactly. Now, I want to bring you up to modern times, and Peter mentioned the Bible and said that's where our legal system comes from. That's partially correct. What I'm going to show you is, and let me hesitate here for a second, a lot of people think the common law and the Constitution came from the Bible. Nothing could be further from the truth. See the man there shaking his head? No, he's absolutely correct. But let me show you what did come from the Bible. It's this statute here. Now, you've got this statute you can use with devastating effect if once you learn it, you apply it. It's like this. And oh, let me also caution you, this is not a magic bullet. It's Title 28, United States Code, Section 453. Now, how many of you who have not read Erwin Rommel can recognize that statute? Okay? This is the most critical statute anywhere in the federal codes. Now, the United States Code consists of 50 volumes, 1 through 50. About 40 of them don't concern you. They're all stuff like agriculture and Indians and that sort of thing. It's got nothing to do with what you're actually going to do in federal court. This statute here, before I explain to you what it is, let me show you the parts of the Bible that it came from. It came from Leviticus 15, verse 21. I'm sorry, that's the wrong one. So it's Leviticus. Peter, which one is that? Slipped my mind. Is it Leviticus 19, verse 15? There you go. Okay, and Deuteronomy 1, 16, and 17. Now, this one you used to be able to find in Black's Law Dictionary in the fourth edition. They finally took it out as they took out the Code of Responsibility for Lawyers and the Code of Judicial Conduct for Judges, and they finally realized these characters had no conception of what they were supposed to be doing. Now, what these two statutes prohibit is respect of persons in judgment. In other words, as I said a few minutes earlier, you cannot have one set of rules for William Kennedy Smith and Neil Bush and another set of rules for the rest of us. This was true 3,500 years ago, and it is supposed to be true today. This is a federal judge's oath of office. The first thing he promises is that he will judge equally alike the rich and the poor. He will uphold the Constitution of the United States. The last four words of this particular oath are, so help me God. Now, these are the same people, I'm sure you can recall, that took the Bible out of the prayer out of the public schools. They're responsible for Roe versus Wade. And let me show you something else here. that is not common knowledge. Now, I'm sure you've all heard of Roe versus Wade, so I don't have to put the citation down. You all know it was enacted in 1973. But let me show you what they actually did with this particular thing. How many people here have actually read that decision? Can I see a show of hands? Roe versus Wade. One fella here. Okay, anyone else? All right. If you'll read... Is this one getting too light? Okay, yeah. Go. my weapon wore out. If you read the decision itself, you're going to find that the United States Supreme Court pulled one of the cleverest moves ever done by the American judiciary. Now, in case you're wondering why part of my pet peeve is the judiciary, it's because these people are the ones who actually make our laws. Congress makes suggestions. But what they did here, and you think I'm kidding, what they did here was something that when I first read, I'm thinking, whoa, wait a minute here. I read the decision. Well, now what Harry Blackmun did, and this guy wasn't even a good lawyer, let alone a decent Supreme Court justice, instead of using anything from the Bible or the Constitution or the English common law, he used the philosophy of the Stoics in order to justify his decision that life did not begin until a baby had passed the birth canal. Okay? So I'm sitting there in a law life here, I'm thinking, Stoics? Why do we have a bunch of dead Greeks deciding our legal system? So I went up and looked up Stoics. And Stoics, now they tell you today it was a philosophy, but actually it was a religious group that followed this particular pagan god. And I thought, okay, I see this, there's some religious connotation here. So I thought, okay, Zeus, who the dickens is he? So I looked up Zeus and traced him out, and I found he was the Jupiter Olympus of the Romans. Can anybody tell me what his name was in Hebrew? Anybody? Bingo. Right here. You probably recognize this name. This was the guy that Elijah cut all the 450 of them, I think. He decapitated them. This is actually what the Supreme Court did on January 22nd, 1973, and it'll explain to you when you read the news why these people in the federal judiciary are so adamant about no Bible in the public schools, no prayer in the public schools, no nativity scenes in the public parks, is because what the Supreme Court actually did on January 22nd, 1973, is they installed Baal worship as the official religion of the United States. And if you take this to its logical conclusion and you say, wait a minute here, what we've got is we've got these people up in the judiciary wearing these black robes. Anybody tell me where those black robes came from?
Mourning the death of the King of England, isn't it?
No. I'm sorry, but unfortunately it's worse than that. Pardon? No, but you're close. You know, I like this. I mean, you people are actually participating. A lot of times I get people just sit there like, you know, bumps on a log and don't say anything. The judicial robes of the federal judiciary, the black robes, are left over from the pagan Roman Empire. This was the empire that codified class distinctions. If you were royalty, you couldn't be tortured. If you were common people, well, then they could put you on the rack or the thumb screw or whatever they felt like. And that eventually kind of backfired on them too, because the exception to that was treason. And when they started getting the privileged elite, which is, I don't know if you've noticed it or not, but that's what they're doing now in this society. It used to be that when the police and the judicial system landed on people, they only landed on the poor, the people who couldn't defend themselves. But if you've noticed lately, just in the last few years, they're getting everybody. And eventually it's going to backfire on them, just like it did in ancient Rome. But what happened was, in Rome, they said, well, all right, if it's treason, then you can torture even the aristocracy. Well, pretty soon everything was treason, just as today, in all American criminal cases, everything is conspiracy. Now, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you some other things. Now, Peter brought me up a sign here. It said, you know, like, I've got 15 minutes on this segment. Now, the reason this is going to be just a little bit disjointed is because we want to make sure you've got tapes when you leave here. So if his tape machine runs up before I stop talking, which, believe me, it's easy for me to do. I can overrun any tape machine out there. What's going to wind up happening is you'll get a kind of disjointed account of this. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to keep it in increments, even though the subject matter won't be precise as far as I wanted to cover the class distinctions in the legal system. Next, I'm going to teach you what the common law actually is and was. Then we're going to go to constitutional law, which I think you're going to get a couple of eye-openers on that. Then I'm going to actually show you how to fill out the paperwork, how to frame an issue, how to walk it through the courts, how to do legal research, that sort of thing. And in each segment, what I'm asking for are questions. Now, I've pretty well covered the class distinctions on the legal system. I've covered the judicial oath of office, that our federal judicial system is actually an alien religion. I know it sounds a little heavy, but if you actually watch these people, and again, remember, the law is not what I tell you it is. It's what's in the books. Go read the books yourself. See if I'm right. I'll give you an example. There's a federal judge named Gordon Thompson. Attorney was in there trying to defend some pro-life activists. And this judge says, okay, here's 40 words you can't use, and here are 6 defenses you're not allowed to use either. And I'm looking at this thing, well, you know, so much for the First Amendment, so much for assistance of counsel, because these people are determined to keep this agenda wrapped around our throats. There are ways to overcome it, but first I want to get you to recognize what we have. What we have, to some extent, is an alien religion that runs our legal system, and we also have a caste system, legal system. Now, you can still make it work. I'm going to show you how. But you've got to understand, when you're going into court, there isn't a judge up there who cares about your rights, because as far as he's concerned, you don't have any. You're a peasant. In fact, one of the things I wanted to point out earlier was that as you may have noticed, I don't have a lot of respect for the judiciary, because, as I also pointed out earlier, the judge's robes come from the Roman Empire. And how much respect can you have for somebody that's sitting up there in a 2,000-year-old Halloween costume? I mean, really. You know, look at them like that and they won't scare you. All right, now, before I get into the common law, are there any questions on what I've raised so far? Now, don't be bashful, because I'm here to teach you whether you want to be taught or not. In other words, if I have to, I'll cram this information down your throat. This man here, yes, sir.
Continue to say federal judges.
Right.
This judgeship, how far down the spectrum does it go? All the way to JP?
No.
Repeat the question.
Okay, good question. The man asked...
we have microphones. If you'll come up to the mics, the question will get on the tape.
Yeah,
and,
there we go.
We can all hear it.
Okay, well, this man asked the question, does the federal judiciary go all the way down to, like, justice of the peace? No, it does not. The federal judiciary is separate from the state judiciary. Federal judiciary, you have United States Supreme Court here in Texas. The next lower level would be the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals in New Orleans. And then lower than that, you'd have the federal district court, such as here in Dallas, Texas. Come on up here, would you, sir? Now, the state judges, you have a completely different parallel system. You have the state Supreme Court, probably an appellate court, district courts, of which you have an absolute wad of them here in Dallas, and then your justice of the peace and people like that, they're about as low as you go. But those are state judges, not federal judges. Go
okay,
ahead.
What I'm saying is the corruption that is at the federal level and the Halloween costumes that they wear, mm-hmm. does it go all the way down in depth as far as the judges that are sitting on the JP court?
Yes,
are they all the same quality of people?
That's it. Yeah, they're all well, same quality of people. That's boy, am I going to have fun with this one? Yeah, yeah. I mean, you want to talk about a 14-day-old rotten pizza? Yeah, that's about the quality you're getting with these characters, because most judges, all federal judges and almost all state judges, are political appointees. They're not put there because they know anything. They're put there because they've got a political connection. And if you don't believe that one, read some of this utter trash coming out of the United States Supreme Court. If you really want to see what the legal system is supposed to be, what I would suggest you do is this. When you go to a law library and you want to know about a particular subject and you want the grounding in what it's supposed to be, skip the published opinions written by judges, Supreme Court reporters, federal reporters, which is the appellate court, federal supplements, district courts, and I'm going to get into those more heavily. But if you want to see what the law is supposed to be, go to the law journals. Some of these law professors, I mean, when you read their stuff and then you compare it to what some of these low-quality morons in their Halloween costumes are doing, you'll realize, whoops, wait a minute here. This isn't the way things are supposed to be. I'll give you one example, the Second Amendment, right to keep and bear arms, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. We did a survey of several of the law journal articles, and occasionally you'll find some liberal bimbo, if you'll forgive the expression, who will come out with some really asinine article on this on the Second Amendment, but you'll come up with some of these law professors, they'll point out, like, the Second Amendment was enacted so that the common citizens could be a counterweight to government forces. It was enacted so that people could protect themselves from organized government bodies. And one of the things, one of the reasons that the Supreme Court never addresses this issue, if you get back far enough into the common law, the Second Amendment carries with it the implied right to revolt. And obviously they're not teaching that in the schools these days. So if you have a particular legal problem, if you go to the law journal articles first, then what you'll see is when you actually get in to the published opinions the way the Supreme Court thinks things ought to be, you're going to find that these guys, at least 7 times out of 10, are strictly out to lunch. But again, they're political appointees. I mean, just because somebody's on the Supreme Court and these idiots on these talk show hosts speak to them in hushed, or about them in hushed and reverential tones, these people are not the font of ultimate wisdom. They're 9 lawyers, for Pete's sake. And they're 9 lawyers, none of whom had to pass a test to get the job, unless you're talking about the test that Clarence Thomas took on his sex life. I mean, come on. You know, how does that qualify you to adjudicate the constitutional issue? Next question.
You said the 1973 Roe versus Wade established Baal religion
as the official religion of the United States.
Could you tell us exactly how, what you mean by that, how that was done?
Okay, well, they did it by writing the opinion, because if you read the dissenting opinion by Rehnquist and White there, both of them say, wait a minute here, this is judicial legislation. The Congress is supposed to enact legislation, the executive is supposed to enforce it, and the judiciary is supposed to interpret it. But the judiciary does not interpret anything these days. With the Constitution, they amend it. With the legislation, they twist it. What they actually did, now bear in mind, the two hallmarks of Baal worship are infanticide, in other words, killing children, and usury. Now, if you go into any almost any court proceeding, you're going to find that if a judge can render a decision pro-life or pro-choice, 99 times out of 100, it will be pro-choice. If he can render a decision in favor of the common citizen, or in favor of the usurer, 90% of the time, it will be in favor of the usurer. And what they've done is they've actually installed this alien religion by judicial legislation. And this isn't something I'm going to spend this whole seminar on, because quite frankly, that's not what anybody's here for. But what I invite you to do is read Roe versus Wade, shepherdize it, which I'm going to teach you how to do, read the later cases that quote it, and you're going to see there's this whole body of law that has absolutely nothing to do with the Constitution as enacted or the statutes, with the exception of these last bunch of idiots we've got in Congress with this FACE Act, Freedom of Access to Care entrances, because you know, a couple of baby killers got whacked. Well, you know, my question is if we have a legal system that's not based on protecting the high priests of this cult, it seems to me it would make a lot more sense to enact a federal law to protect the entrances to McDonald's. I mean, there have been more people killed in one McDonald's by one guy down in San Ysidro, California, than there have every baby killer in the nation since this has started. And this is a ridiculous law, and what's happened is the congressmen we have now are so ignorant and stupid, they're even worse than their predecessors who were bad enough, that they enact this stuff that there's no authority for. Can anyone show me anywhere in the 14th Amendment, which is what the Supreme Court based Roe versus Wade on, where they can justify this? It won't happen, because it's not there. The people who wrote the 14th Amendment never had it in their minds that it was going to be used in this fashion. And I can show you 19th century case law. One of the best is Ex parte Bain. It's in the 121st volume of the United States Reporters, page 1 from 1887. And they tell you that you must always interpret a constitution through the eyes of the people who wrote it. Now, are there any other questions on this part of the program so far? I see Peter's got a 5-minute sign for me, and I'd kind of like to keep this going. so that I could write up the dates that are crucial to your understanding of the common law from the day that it was enacted. And again, common law did not come from the Bible. Here we go. Here's a question.
Yes, Mike, on this, on this, make a comment on the Roe versus Wade.
Right.
Would it be considered that since the United States doesn't recognize anybody's rights except for the citizens, and they don't become a citizen until they get a birth certificate or they're naturalized in one way or another. And so until they're born into the United States and receive a certificate of birth, then they don't have any rights. Would this be something that they might have been considering?
Well, that's a hell of
a... Who knows what they're considering?
Okay. That's a hell of a question. There's only one thing wrong with that line of argument. He's saying, well, you're not a citizen until you have a birth certificate that says you're a citizen. Well, the problem that you've got there is if you follow that line of reasoning, you have to completely flush the Fifth Amendment. No person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Now, a person under the English common law, and this is what I'm going to show you how to use this. See, this idea of the common law being some, you know, magical thing you can wave in a judge's face and he's supposed to, you know, shrink like a vampire from a cross or something, doesn't happen. But it can be used. Under the common law, and you'll find this, and here's another set of books, if you want a really good background in how the Constitution was written, it's called Blackstone's Commentaries on the Laws of England. It's usually a 2 to 5 volume set of books. Blackstone's Commentaries, there he goes, right up there, okay? That's probably the best book you can get to understanding the language that the Constitution itself was written in. And Blackstone will tell you that person meant from the time of quickening, not from the time of birth, not from the first trimester, not from anything else. It was from the time that the child first moved in the womb, all right? However, even Blackstone didn't quite get it right, because if you want to know what a person is or a man is, you go to Job 3, verse 3, which was the set of laws they used even before Blackstone, where Job says, cursed is the night a man-child is conceived. He does not say, shame on the afternoon a piece of meat glued itself to a uterus wall. In other words, under God's laws, it's a person from the very instant of conception. Under Baal worship, it's not a person until it passes the birth canal. Now, I think we pretty well discussed that one. All right, any other questions here? Yes, sir, right here.
I've got one, since you were talking about the FACE Act, et cetera, about Paul Hill, who shot the abortionist in Florida, and his defense was going to be justifiable homicide, and the judge ruled that he couldn't use that defense, so basically that was it. Any comments on that?
Well, yeah, because, and we're going to get into that on the Sixth Amendment, where we talk about impartial jury. The problem with that judge's ruling is that when a judge hamstrings your defense, then you've been denied due process, you've been denied assistance of counsel. The fact is, under God's laws, it was justifiable homicide, but under Baal worship, you've just killed the high priest. You know, shame on you. What do you got, Peter?
Okay, here's what we're going to do. Is this on? Are we on? What we're going to do is we're going to take our first break right at this point. I would like to end this set with reminding our tape audience, if you do not have our information pack, please write for it. Peter Simpson, 4842 North Magnolia, Chicago, 60640-4710. Our phone is 312-878-0681. Our dedicated fax, 0682. We, two of the gentlemen in this room, Michael included, in 1988 permanently closed 3 abortion clinics by suing them under racketeer influence corrupt organizations. We are looking for a quartermaster corps to mount RICO the Baby Killers 2. And if you would like to be part of RICO the Baby Killers 2, please contact me. We're going to take a short break, and we hope you do too. We thank you.
One more thing here, people. And I'm not saying this to be unfriendly, okay, but there will be no questions during the breaks on an individual basis for one very simple reason. If you have a question, someone else has got the same question. What we're trying to do here is teach everyone here, not just isolated individuals, everything that we can. So whatever question you've had, If you feel it's too ridiculous, you don't want to say it in public, put it on a note. I'll answer it, but let me answer it for the whole class. Okay, take a break, and then it'll be battle stations here in about what, Peter?
15 minutes to battle stations. 15 minutes.
To that, I had a couple things brought to me during the break, and like I said, I'm not answering any questions during the break because everybody needs it now. Young man over here, didn't you have a question? Would you come up here and tell us what it was? Or did you forget already? Well, somebody else, okay. A fellow brought me this here. The president doesn't take an oath to defend the American flag or the Statue of Liberty. That's absolutely correct. He takes an oath to uphold the United States Constitution. And the problem is that by the time the Supreme Court gets through mangling it, if you're taking an oath to uphold the Constitution as the United States Supreme Court upholds it, you're basically taking an oath to uphold what's written on a piece of toilet paper. It doesn't mean anything. Now, as far as the Statue of Liberty goes, I'm kind of glad he brought that up because that's another one of my pet peeves. If you go to any encyclopedia and you find a statue of the Colossus of Rhodes is 121 feet high. It's an iron framework covered with copper. It has a headdress representing the sun's rays. It's holding an upraised torch. Colossus of Rhodes, we now know, is the Statue of Liberty. It's just the Colossus in drag. And if you, at least I got a laugh out of somebody. Anyway, the Colossus of Rhodes, you also know, is a statue of Baal. In other words, that clunker sitting here in New York Harbor is a direct insult to God Almighty, and all these people that did all this singing its praises and all that kind of stuff, they spent $275 million refurbishing that piece of junk. Think how many family farms they could have saved. Now, next thing we're going to get into here is the English Common Law. And the reason they called it the Common Law was this. In the time of Henry II, we're going all the way back into the 12th century. Every shire, which you also know as a county here in this country, in England had a different set of rules. Now, can you imagine driving from Dallas County, the next county over, and there's all sorts of laws you're not even familiar with. You break one of them, the next thing you know, you're sitting in a jail someplace because you didn't know what the rules were. You crossed the county line. Well, that's what was happening at the time of Henry II. And he was really getting perturbed about this because it was messing up his tax base. And Henry II, incidentally, wasn't that bad a guy. He came back from one war, and he asked people how the judges had been treating them. And they said, oh, it's awful. There's too many of them. Well, the whole country, they had 18 of them. So he cut them down to five. And I'm going to show you what our people had to say about the same thing in 1792. But because of the frustration with all these different legal systems, he brought in a fellow, a Latin scholar, and a sheriff by the name of Ranulph de Glanville. Now, de Glanville was quite a fellow, very fluent in Latin, and Henry II said, here, Ranulph, here's what I want. I want all the statutes that are common to all of England, and we're not going to have this business of going from county to county and the rules changing and people getting locked up over it. He said, this nonsense over with. So what he said was, and this is where the word common law comes from, he said, I want all the laws written down that are common to the country of England. In other words, the common law. So Ranulph says, okay, says, I can handle that. And he gets into it and he realizes he's got a nightmare. There's no way he can harmonize all this garbage. So what he does, because he's such a slick Latin scholar, he does what he can, and then he goes back to the 12 tables of the Roman Empire and says, okay, these will work. The king will never know the difference. So in 1187, he hands Henry II this book and says, here are all the laws of England. The fact they were also the laws of the Roman Empire never was mentioned to anybody. Now, Ranulph was kind of a slick dude. He got removed from office twice for corruption, but he was slick enough to get back in. Now, the common law went along fine as best they could until 1215. Now, anybody who doesn't recognize this date, Magna Carta, all right? Now, here's the funny part. First place, Magna Carta did not apply to the common herd. For the most part, it applied to the barons because they had already forgotten the laws or what they had learned, or the Saxons had learned at Hastings. It seems like every 150, 200 years, you have to start all over again and teach the people in charge that, hey, we're human beings too. Can anybody tell me how long Magna Carta lasted when it was first enacted? Nobody want to guess? 9 weeks. King John, who was basically, he's kind of a little scrawny dirtbag, he repudiated Magna Carta 9 weeks. It was not brought back until almost 50 years later when one of the English kings needed a loan. And the baron says, you aren't getting squat, we're not going along with it until you reinstate Magna Carta. And from that time on, from 50 years later, even unto this day, you will find clauses of Magna Carta in many of our state constitutions, such as the courts will always be open, there will be a remedy for every injury, no free man will be imprisoned without due process of law. Now, 1275, we're up to Edward I, and some of you may have seen him in that movie Braveheart. It's an interesting movie, and it's about 80% accurate. He was kind of hard on the Scots, but he was pretty decent to his own people, because in the Statutes of Westminster that he enacted, and he didn't have a parliament or a lawmaking body or anything, he just sat down and wrote all this stuff up himself, 54 statutes. And one of them is that there would be no respect of persons in judgment. There was not going to be one set of laws for William Kennedy Smith, another set of laws for the rest of us. The problem is that when Edward I enacted this, his judges didn't get the message. So in 1289, he decided he was going to remove every corrupt judge in England so that they would start following the rules as he laid them down. You know how many judges he wound up with when he was through? Anybody want to guess? Well, you're close. Two. Okay. Absolutely correct. So in 1289, he scraped all but two off the bench. Now, he died. He died in the early 14th century. So by 1340, the judges were back to their usual tricks of complicating everything and creating so much confusion that nobody could get a court case taken care of. So in 1340, the English Parliament passed a very curious statute. I think you're real close to seeing that in this country today. You may even see it before the end of the century. What this statute did was it took cases out of the hands of the judges, and it put them in the hands of commissioners who had no formal legal training or experience, and they cleaned them up. In 1489, now watch this, this is 200 years, and you're going to see this is almost like clockwork. Henry VII had taken over England after the Wars of the Roses. He was like the third party that came in. In 1489, Henry VII had the exact same problem with the judiciary. He had to fine a lot of them, he had to imprison a lot of them, in other words, he had to teach them some manners. Well, things weren't too bad. We went go into the 16th century under the reign of Henry VIII, and fortunately for the common people, Henry VIII was mostly into beheading wives and, you know, other nobility and people like that. So it didn't really filter down to the common herd, so to speak. 1603, we have James I, and I'm missing a date here. I should have had 1607. James I, a lot of you, I'm sure, I doubt there's anybody here who hasn't heard of a King James Bible. What you may not be aware of, unless you've read the foreword to the Geneva Bible, how many people here have Geneva Bibles? Okay, then you understand. You know what I'm about to hit you with next? James I, who authorized the King James Bible, was a flaming homosexual. He liked little boys a lot better than he liked girls, and in 1626, he died of a disease that the symptoms very much read like how people die of AIDS today. There was a very famous English writer in the 19th century who used to call him, instead of his highness, used to call him his sowness, as in female pig. And this particular writer, who I got all this information from, you've probably heard of. It's in chapter 13 of A Child's History of England. Writer's name is Charles Dickens, and he's the one who lays all this out. Now this James I created so many problems with the English legal system. Well, let me back up here a little bit. Now, some of the states in the Union, Missouri is one of them, they date the common law from 1607, the fourth year of the reign of James I. In the federal system, they date the common law from 1789, which I'll describe here directly. In 1628, now James I had been dead for a couple of years, but his son, Charles I, was just as much of an idiot as his father. He had no conception of the rights of other people. They were under the divine right of kings. And their reasoning was is that a king was a gift from God. If you got a good one, that was a gift from God. If you got a bad one, you still had to go along with the program because that was a punishment sent from God. So either way, no matter what a king did, it was from the hand of God himself. Well, they ran into some serious disagreements with this attitude. And in 1628, the English Parliament presented what is called now the Petition of Right. They say, hey, look, we've got to have some rules here. We've got to have some protection. We just can't have the king's officers wandering around throwing whoever they want into prison, taking whoever's property they want, you know, kind of like the BATF does these days. And didn't get anywhere there. Now, see, I'm missing another date here, too. All right, well, Charles I could not be reasoned with. So by 1642, the English people had had enough, and what they had was a civil war that lasted for 7 years. And very close to the end of the Civil War, I believe it was about 1649, Oliver Cromwell and his people just had Charles I beheaded. Now, beheading at the time was something reserved for common people. Kings were supposed to be above the law, and all the kings of Europe pleaded for his life, and Cromwell and company said, this guy's just got too far out of line, he's got to go, and they whacked his head off. Their problem was is that Cromwell and his people were not any more familiar with the principles of government than Charles I was. Charles I was a libertine, but Oliver Cromwell passed laws that nobody could follow, and so he wound up imprisoning people, executing people, a lot of which was uncalled for. The Stuarts came back, and that's what I'm talking about. James I was a Stuart. They were from Scotland, Charles I. He was beheaded. Now, his son, Charles II, came back in the Restoration of 1660.
And this right here, yeah, let me get this one here.
Make it dark.
Well, it's about as dark as it's going to get. Anyway, Charles II came back for the Restoration in 1660, and it was kind of like the parable about the frogs who wanted a king. You know, he'd send them an alligator that would eat them. And what he did was, the first thing he did was he tried to reintroduce Roman Catholicism as the official religion of England. Of course, nobody was going along with that. But then what he did, about 1671, Charles II, and he did a whole lot of other stuff too, but this is something you may recognize, he passed what were known as the game laws. And that's where everybody had to give up their guns except the nobility, except for sporting purposes. In other words, you could have a gun provided you had a big enough estate where you could show that you could hunt on it. And the English people got more and more fed up with him, so that by 1688, they brought in William and Mary of Orange and just told this guy, hey, you know, hit the bricks. The year after, the English Parliament, to make sure they were never going to have another problem like the Stuarts, they enacted the Bill of Rights. In other words, there was a Bill of Rights for the English people 100 years and some change before we got ours. The 4th, 5th, and 6th Amendments, exactly as we understand them now. They're almost word for word the same. Problem that they had was that the English judges weren't much better, and in some cases much worse, than the ones we have now, so that by 1776, people were once again fed up with the legal system, and they said, okay, we've had it. They had a war over it. And in 1789, we had the Federal Constitution enacted. Now, the reason the Constitution was not ratified, if you read the accounts of that day, is, as Patrick Henry said, I smelt a rat. In other words, there was something wrong with this document because there was no Bill of Rights in it, and the only way they were going to get the common people to hold still for it and ratify it. And when I say common people, bear this in mind. In 1789 and 1791, 90% of the people in this country could not vote. They had nothing to do with the government. If you were an Indian, forget it. If you were a slave, forget it. If you were a woman, forget it. If you did not own property, forget it. In other words, 10% of the people who inhabited the Eastern Seaboard could actually take part in the electoral process. And it was those 10%
they couldn't get this thing passed. And one of the reasons they couldn't get it passed is, I know a lot of people run around saying, oh, the Constitution is, you know, it came from God and this, that, and the other. On the contrary, if you read the federal Constitution, I'm going to get to it here directly, what you're going to find is that parts of it, such as Article 1, Section 10, Clause 1, no state can impair the obligation of contract, that was enacted to protect banks and financiers. If it weren't for that clause in the main body of the federal Constitution, when these farmers start going under in the various states, the state legislatures could pass debtor relief laws. But that doesn't happen because of that clause. That clause is a direct contradiction of Leviticus 25, verses 34 to 37, and some of the people back then knew that. Bring us up to 1791. Well, so nobody's going to hold still for this. The 10% of the people who can vote are not going to hold still for this Constitution. And the fact is, it wasn't that bad a piece of work to begin with, simply because if you looked at it and people went by it, it was a fairly good idea for keeping the government together. You didn't have all the power concentrated in one set of hands. So in 1791, they enacted the Bill of Rights. Now, the Bill of Rights, everything in it and the federal Constitution itself is written in the language of the English common law. All right? And here's the one thing you have to remember when you're going to litigate something. And I would suggest, if you're really serious about this, and I was just talking to Mr. Fox over here, and apparently I paid $80 for a set of Blackstone's commentaries that were paperback. He apparently selling the hardcover for $45. I would very strongly suggest that you get a copy, because without that set of books, when you read the actual language of the federal Constitution, you're not going to know any more about what it means than a federal judge does. But if you actually read Blackstone's commentaries and say, okay, there's a whole section in there on the Second Amendment, right to keep and bear arms. Under Blackstone, the right to keep and bear arms was not a constitutional right or a statutory right. It was an inalienable, God-given right. In fact, what he pointed out was, what Mr. Blackstone pointed out was, is that that's the most important right you've got, because without the weapons to ensure your other rights, you have no rights at all, as they found out here down in Waco not too long ago. Now, you have to take, once you take that, and here's how you use this in a court. This is the one thing that's critical that I have to get through to you. If you're going to argue a constitutional point, and if you're going up against bad case law, if you're going up against someone who you think might be dangerous in a courtroom, it's this. And you can run this on a Westlaw search, and you'll find case after case that will tell you this. In the absence of statute, you go according to the common law. In other words, if you have a clause in the Constitution, a well-regulated militia, all right? Militia is not what a federal judge tells you it is. Militia, you go to Blackstone's commentaries, and you look up militia, and it simply means every able-bodied male. Now, the irony here is that the judiciary is at loggerheads with the legislative. Because any of you who want to know what militia is, watch this. Title 10, United States Code, Section 311, Paragraph A. That's the definition by Congress that has been around since 1792, since the first Militia Act. Title 10, United States Code, Section 311A. What that is the militia is defined not only in Blackstone's commentaries, but by federal statute that is still on the books even unto this day, is every able-bodied male between the ages of 17 and 44, period. That's what militia is. And unfortunately, the courts have gerrymandered to the point where it's completely unrecognizable. Oh, got another one. Got a reload here, okay. Now, 1791, Bill of Rights is enacted. Again, if you have a copy of Blackstone's commentaries, there's an excellent index in it. What you can do is you can read part of the Constitution. You can go to the index, like if you want to look up grand jury or right to keep and bear arms, and Blackstone will tell you the reasoning. See, he not only tells you what the definitions are, but he gives you the reasons that a particular amendment was enacted, or the reason something works in this particular fashion. Now, in 1792, remember, we just had indictment by grand jury in 1791. In 1792, the grand juries were making what are called not only indictments, but presentments. And there's a lot of confusion today on what that means, but they were making a lot of comments on things that had nothing to do with indicting criminals, and one of which was, there was one down in Georgia in 1792. Remember, they'd only had the federal judiciary for 36 months, the Judiciary Act of 1789. And the grand jury in 1792, federal grand jury, says, we've got too many federal judges. You know, we need to get rid of some of these jerks. You know how many they had back then? 13. Okay? 1973, you're already familiar with. I'm going to skip the 19th century. As far as the common law goes, with one exception, if you want to see some really great legal work, if you want to understand how the Constitution works past Blackstone's commentaries, you go to the 19th century federal cases, because remember, back then, all the way up until 1900, we only had about 50 federal judges in the entire United States. Now they're like the movie Gremlins. They're all over the place. There's hundreds of them. And back then, they also had to know something. But if you read 19th century case law, you will find things that you don't even suspect. For example, today, and I'm going to show you how to do this. I'm going to show you how to bring a federal criminal indictment against someone, or at least cause so much grief to the federal prosecutors that they'll do almost anything just to get rid of you. In the 19th century, if you get the case law, and I'm going to get a little heavier into this, into how you recognize what's a federal case prior to 1880, what one looks like between 1880 and 1934, 1934 to the present day, that sort of thing. I'm actually going to show you how to read this stuff, how to look it up. But if you take a particular subject and you read the 19th century case law, and it gets better as the century goes on, you're going to find that what the law was in the 19th century, even as understood according to constitutional understanding, and you don't interpret a constitution, you either understand it or you don't. The later you get into the century, the better it gets. And then all of a sudden, about the beginning of the 20th century, everything starts going south because Congress starts amending the Constitution, which they don't have the authority to do. Until today, we have literally legal anarchy. Now let me show you about legal anarchy. Anybody here, and I know some people here have read Roe versus Wade, or at least I thought that's what you said. Has anybody here read Planned Parenthood versus Casey, Supreme Court case from 1992? It's mentioned in the foreword of the Geneva Bible. What's wrong with this is, if you read this case, these characters on the United States Supreme Court, literally, and I've got it quoted word for word in the foreword, they gave themselves the power to amend the Constitution. Just as in 1803, they gave themselves the power to interpret it for all three branches of government. And the year after that, Thomas Jefferson wrote a letter to Abigail Adams and said, this decision, Marbury versus Madison, Supreme Court case from 1803, where the Supreme Court gives itself the right to decide what is constitutional and what is not for the other two branches of government, he said, will make the judiciary the most despotic branch. Let me prove it to you. And I don't think, I know I'm preaching to the choir here to some extent, but here's something. When you tell other people, look, this country is not run by elected representatives, it's run by judges. And here's how you prove it. In fact, think about this for a minute. When someone says, oh, no, that's not true, say, fine. When's the last time a representative, federal or state, did anything for you? And the odds are probably never. When's the last time he did anything to you? Odds are probably never. When's the last time a judge did something to you? And about two times out of three, a person will look at it and say, whoa, wait a minute, yeah, you're right. You know, I got shafted by this judge or bent over the trash barrel by that one. The fact is that non-elected representatives at every level of the government, primarily judges, are the ones who actually run the country. I'm going to show you how to deal with that. But I want to give you the background here first on the English common law. Again, we start 1187, Ranulph de Glanville, laws common to all of England. We go through the history of it. This is my favorite one here, where they just took everything out of the hands of the judges. And we go all the way up till 1992, where we don't even have a constitution anymore because the Supreme Court has given itself the authority to amend it. In other words, you got nine lawyers elected by no one, qualified to do nothing, and they're making decisions that in a monarchy they'd probably be taken out and beheaded for. Now, do we have any questions on the common law before I get to constitutional law? Yes, sir.
You talked about 1607 something happening, but we really didn't get anything in that
particular. Oh, okay. A lot of states, the common law, now again, in the absence of statute, you go according to the common law. Okay? Now, at the federal level, the common law stops in 1789. In other words, when our Constitution was enacted, we no longer had a common law. We had a Constitution, even though it was written in that language. So from that time on, we either went according to the Constitution or by statute. But some states, such as the state of Missouri, do not date their common law antecedents to 1789. They date them, as in Missouri, to the fourth year of James I, 1607. Does that make it any plainer for you?
What happened in particular in 1607 that James I did that started, that they could point to?
Well, that's a good question, and I don't know. You know, maybe he had another boyfriend then. Okay. I couldn't really tell you.
All right, you mentioned 1791. You talked about indictments, but you really didn't give us an explanation of how that process, indictments versus 1792, the present presentments.
Oh, okay. Well, see, I didn't want to get too deep into that because that's on constitutional law. That's the next section. In fact, let's save that for the Fifth Amendment because what I want to show you, the word indictment, by the way, it's from the French, indicter, to point out. In other words, you did it. Okay, you're in the jackpot now, and you have indictment by grand jury or presentment by grand jury. At the beginning of the 19th century, a prosecutor was not what you understand today as a prosecutor. He was not somebody on the public trough. He was actually a citizen just like us that would take his complaint, he would take it to the grand jury, and he would sign his name at the foot of the indictment, and it simply meant someone who shared the costs. That's all it meant. And what's happened is, in the last century and a half, the courts and the legislatures have changed the meaning of what indictment by grand jury meant. Okay, I'll cover that more thoroughly in the section on constitutional law, because I'm going to show you what it is, how to use it, how to overcome what some of the courts have done. Okay, anything else on the common law?
Talked about 90% of the people could not vote in 1791.
That's correct.
10%. Only 10% of the people then ratified the Constitution?
That is correct. Yeah, in fact, actually, and I'm glad you brought that up too, because the Constitution, everybody looks at this document came from God. On the contrary, of the 55 people who wrote the original Constitution, and it, you know, I'm not knocking the Constitution, but I'm telling you, it's man-made law. There's flaws in it. Of the 55 people who engineered this thing, 25 were lawyers. Now, what does that tell you? All right? 11 had large mercantile interests, 15 of them were slave owners, 20 of them, and because there's some overlap here, made their living by usury. Now, can anybody here who has not read Erwin Rommel tell me how many people at the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia were members of the small farmers and mechanics classes? Anybody want to guess? Bingo. Throw that man a fish. Zero. That is the correct answer. There was not one person there representing the common citizen. Okay, yes, sir. Next question.
Okay, back on the issue of the citizen being able to prosecute on the indictment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, back in the 19th century. Wouldn't that be champerty? Wouldn't they also share in the spoils?
No, because back then, champerty would have to do with, and again, you need a Black's Law Dictionary, but for the most part, it simply deals with churning, if I recall correctly. Now, Robert, have you got a Black's Law Dictionary over there? Okay, yeah, he's got something. Would you please look that up for me? Because what I'm afraid of here is if I shoot from the top of my head, I'm subject to give you some misinformation. I'm going to have him give you the exact definition. No, prosecution, when you sign an indictment, was for a criminal offense. And back then, a criminal offense had penalties such as execution, flogging, imprisonment, that sort of thing. But champerty, I believe, have you found it yet, Peter?
Yeah.
Yeah, come up here and give us an accurate definition so that I don't wind up making a fool out of myself.
This will come to you from Robert Fox's first edition, Black's 1891. Champerty, a bargain made by a stranger with one of the parties to a suit by which such third person undertakes to carry on the litigation at his own cost and risk in consideration of receiving, if he wins the suit, a part of the land or other subject sought to be recovered by the action. The purchase of an interest in a thing in dispute with the object of maintaining and taking part in the litigation, and there's a site 7 Bing 378, which I bet is...
English.
Is English law.
Yeah.
First edition.
Yeah, yeah, it's English law. Okay. Next
and
question.
No, hang on, just one second. Do we have anything different? It's basically the same in Bouvier's also.
Yeah, see, what you're doing, that's a civil. In other words, what somebody's doing is he's basically using a lawsuit the way you'd use a crap table at Las Vegas, but it has nothing to do with criminal. Okay, next question up here, ma'am.
You mentioned that the common law ended when the Constitution was formed, and I noticed that lawyers today still mention the common law in their pleadings and in their briefs. Can you explain why?
Oh, okay. No, that's a good question. No, it did not end, all right? It was frozen. In other words, see, the common law continued to develop in England because the common law in England consisted of just everything. Court decisions, statutes, when the king blew his nose, I mean, it's just everything. It was frozen in 1789. And now that's true, lawyers do use that today because almost all your state civil actions are according to the common law. In fact, here's another book you need if you want to get into being a real high-powered sewer. It's probably the best book ever written on civil litigation. It's called Prosser's, P-R-O-S-S-E-R apostrophe S, Law of Torts, T-O-R-T-S. Now, Prosser goes all the way back for centuries into the English common law and shows you that most of your civil causes of action, assault and battery, trespass, trover and conversion, you name it, intentional infliction of emotional distress, that's a fairly recent one, abuse of process did not actually arise until the late 18th century. But he shows you where all these causes of action arose in the English courts. And now remember what I said, in the absence of statute, you go according to the common law. And there were simply, for the most part, it was not necessary in most of the states of the Union to enact statutes to cover things that were already quite well covered by the common law, such as an assault and battery case. In other words, if somebody comes up and knocks the stuffing out of you, and you take him to court, say in one of these Texas district courts, and you sue him, you're not suing him according to statute, you're suing him according to the precepts laid down in the common law before the Republic was founded. Al, you're
when
next.
When you say that the common law ended in 1789, it didn't go any further, didn't evolve any further, are you talking about strictly at the federal level, or
no.
Are we also talking at the state level?
No, I'm also talking at the state level, because remember, the common law came from England. And as of 1789, actually as of 1776, this country was no longer part of the British Empire. So what you have today, and it didn't end, it was frozen. In other words, the principles laid down under the common law at the federal level are still used from 1789, but in some states, again like Missouri, the principles laid down in the common law were frozen, and I don't know why they did this. People who wrote the Missouri Constitution apparently had something up their sleeves. It's frozen from 1607. In other words, the meaning of the common law in this country has not changed since 1789. It's been frozen at that level. And anything else that, for example, if you have a federal civil rights complaint, that's not from the common law. That's a thing enacted by statute. In fact, what I'm going to do here, which is going to, I think you're going to enjoy, is I'm going to show you how to wrap a state judge up on the federal civil rights. You just can't do it civilly. I'm going to show you how to do it criminally. Yes, ma'am, you're next.
Yes, we know that in federal court, if there's not a statute that applies, then we go to the state statutes and laws. But what happens when you have a situation where there is no state statute? I have gone to the Attorney General's opinions, but how valid are those Attorney General opinions, and can those be used, or should we go back to the common law? I've been told that the Attorney General's is nothing more than an opinion. It's not law, but in the absence of anything else, what do we use? And I can give you an example if you need one.
Yeah, I'm going to need an example because an Attorney General's opinion is just that. Remember, an Attorney General is just a lawyer who went into politics and succeeded. Those are simply to be used as guides, but it actually takes a judge to make case law or a legislature to make statute law. Give me a specific example here. Let me see if I can address it.
Okay. In Texas, by the way, the Attorney General does not have to be a lawyer. Okay.
Well, that's an improvement over the rest of the union. Okay.
In Texas, we have no law or statute which or even any judicial opinions which regard misdemeanors and withholding of bail, that is all cash bonds for a misdemeanor, say a Class A misdemeanor. And so we went to the law, we went to the judicial opinions, there is nothing. So we had to go to the Attorney General opinions. He said in 1985 that it's unconstitutional to hold a man on a misdemeanor with all cash bail, which is what one of our members went through, spent 3 months in jail on this, and yet we could not get a habeas corpus for him on that. So, you know, what should we have done?
What do you mean you could not get a habeas? You mean
nobody will hear him? It's very.
Wait a minute. Wait. Stop. Who submitted a habeas for him?
I did.
Okay. Now, once the habeas was submitted, how long before it was denied?
He was out of jail before it was denied.
Well, thing is, here's your problem. On a habeas, now I'm going to show you how to get around that. On a habeas, it simply means produce the body. If the body's out there wandering around and they denied it after he got out, that's what they're supposed to do. All right? There's another way you have to attack this problem, which I'm going to show you. It's one of the thermonuclear equivalents of civil litigation. It's called a petition for declaratory relief. Peter and I have had some real fun with these because it just sends people right up the wall. All right? I'm going to show you how to do that. But I'm not going to do it right now because that it really isn't that close on the common law here. Bring it up later if I don't cover it thoroughly enough for you. And believe me, I'll run you through the drill. Let me take this next fella.
What are your comments on the Erie Railroad versus Tompkins case in 1938 concerning the common law?
I paid him to ask that. Okay. Erie versus Tompkins, what happened was in 1938 or thereabouts, there's a fellow walking down a railroad track, and there was a boxcar going past him, and there was a board protruding out, and it just knocked him flat. And so he sued. Now, the problem is, up until that time, what you had was you had the states applying one set of common law rules to their lawsuits, but then a federal judge could come along, and he could quote another set of common law rules as he understood it. And what Erie versus Tompkins did, and it's actually good law when you think about it, because it ended the confusion between the federal and state courts. The Supreme Court said, wait a minute here. You know, we do have such a thing as the 10th Amendment, and you have to recognize the states and their systems. So here's the way it works from now on, is if you have a common law principle in the state of Pennsylvania, which is where this thing took place, and the federal judge thinks that's not the one that should be applied, well, too bad, that's the one you're going to apply. So actually what Erie versus Tompkins did is it ended the confusion as to what the common law was supposed to be between the federal courts and the state courts. Next, yes, sir.
Yeah, something that's unclear, Michael, is the Criminal Code 18.
Title 18, United States Code, what section?
371, for example.
Okay, conspiracy to defraud the United States. You're talking about Section A or Section B?
Well, let's just talk about 371, period.
Okay, it's two sections.
It's without implementing regulations.
Whoa, wait a minute. Whoa, stop. Okay. Let me caution you on something here. When you start talking about implementing regulations, you do not need an implementing regulation if you happen to be the Congress to enact a criminal statute. In fact, the exact opposite is true. For example, under Richard Nixon's regime, the Attorney General, through some ad hoc measures, created what we now know as the federal drug laws, and they took that and ran it into Congress. They weren't supposed to do that. But see, here's what, and I got to caution you on something like this, and I'm not saying this to step on you, okay? I'm here to help you. You have to be real careful about taking a premise that sounds logical to you, picking it up and running with it, predicating your behavior on it. The next thing you know, you find out what life is like for John the Baptist on Herod's birthday. They hand you your head on a platter. See, implementing regulations have nothing to do with anything in the criminal code. If Congress decides tomorrow that all of us are supposed to wear green hats until someone comes along and says, wait a minute, that's unconstitutional and violates this, that, or the other amendment or the clause of the federal constitution, we're all stuck with green hats. You don't need an implementing regulation to enact a criminal statute, period. Okay, next question.
Well, Well, so what's the meaning of having an implementing regulation if it's meaningless, if I understood you?
Because a regulation only applies to the Bureau that enacted it. For example, are you familiar with the Administrative Procedure Act? Okay, that's a little deadly thing, and I hope somebody will remind me to bring this up later, because an agency must obey the rules it promulgates, but an implementing regulation, for the most part, has nothing to do with the public. It's how they regulate the behavior of bureaucracies. It's got nothing to do with you and me. When they start enacting, now, if you want to know about the conspiracy statutes, you don't need to go to implementing regulations to contest them. There's a case from 1949, it's Krulwich versus United States, and if you read this, the opinion, Justice Jackson points out that all conspiracy statutes are unconstitutional because they reduce the district wherein the crime was committed guarantee of the Sixth Amendment to a nullity. Anything that's in violation of the Constitution is void. So if you're going to get into it with that particular statute, don't argue implementing regulations. Argue the fact it conflicts with the district wherein the crime was committed, stricture of the Sixth Amendment. Okay? Yes, sir. Next one.
Could you follow-up question on the Erie versus Tom?
Tom, sure.
Was it true that the federal common law, so-called, was abolished?
No. It was not abolished. What it was harmonized. See, there's a world of difference. All the Supreme Court did said, look, we're not going to have two sets of common law rules in the same state. In other words, when it is a diversity jurisdiction case, in other words, when the issue that you're raising has nothing to do with federal law, except that there is a federal statute that says if you live in Pennsylvania and the dude you're suing is in New York, you can park it in federal court even under this day if its plaintiff and defendant are in different states and the amount of controversy is over $50,000. That's all that means. But all they're saying is under Erie versus Tompkins, we're not going to have two sets of common law rules in the same state on diversity jurisdiction. And I'm going to show you how to draft a complaint on that. What you got, Peter?
We are experiencing some very minor technical difficulties, and just a couple of minutes early, we are going to take a break. On our book table for sale, we have a sample lawsuit for suing IRS agents who are abusing the law, the procedure, and your rights. In our catalog, it is $20. Here at the show, it is $10. In the jurisdictional statement, you will find the Administrative Procedures Act at 5 U.S.C. 706. You will also find petitions for declaratory and injunctive relief, 28 United States Code 2201 and 2202. Mr. Brown is available, as is Dwayne Rogers, who you will hear later, and myself, who you will hear later still. We are all available on a fee basis. We provide numerous services for lawyerless litigators, and we are all contactable through my office, Peter Simpson, care of 4842 North Magnolia, Chicago, 60640-4710. Have to keep those postal guys on the mark, you know.
Yeah, and Peter, I would like to encourage people, any of you who are even remotely interested in constitutional law and where it derived from, get one of these Blackstones so you don't get stuck for $80 like I did.
There you go. Our phone number at the office, 312-878-0681. Our dedicated fax is 24 hours a day, and it's 0682. And we thank you for your attention. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back.